Hi class, this is Ms. Hanlon. I am going to go over the last few questions of the Chapter 5 quiz. I apologize ahead of time if I cough. I'm still not feeling real well. Okay, so I will try to get through these quickly. Number 11 is pretty straightforward. It says, assume that the heights of women are normally distributed with a mean of 63.6 inches and a standard deviation of 2.5 inches. The cheerleaders for a local professional basketball team must be between 65.5 and 68 inches. If a woman is randomly selected, what is the probability that her height is between 65.5 and 68? So because of the information that they gave us and they said to use a standard normal table to find the probability, that means that we can use the normal CDF to solve this problem. So we just need to put in our lower bound as the lower number that they gave us, the 65.5, and the upper bound of 68, and we put in our mean as the mean that they gave us, the 63.6, and the standard deviation of 2.5. And when we do that, we get the answer of D, 0.1844. Okay, so that is pretty straightforward. Number 12 is a little bit different. It says, what happens to the mean and standard deviation of this distribution of sample means as the size of the sample decreases? That's a little confusing. Okay, so let's look at something that we covered briefly in 5.4. This is the central limit theorem, and this is what it's talking about, the sampling distribution of sample means. And it's talking about these two formulas, the mean and the standard error of the mean. And it's talking about what happens whenever the sample size changes and what happens to these two numbers. Well, the sample mean is not in the formula for the sample means, so it does not affect the mean. So the answer for the part about the mean is that it does not change. The mean does not change. So that's the answer for that part. Because it's not the mean, the sample size is not in that formula, so it doesn't affect it. So it's not changed. But for the standard error of the mean, the sample size is in this formula. It's in the denominator of this ratio. So because it's in the denominator, we have to think about how it's going to affect that. Well, because it's inside of a square root, let's think about how that would work. If it, for instance, started out as a 9, that would turn into a 3. And if it changed to a 4, which would be a decrease, which is what they asked us, if it decreased, it would change into a 2. So it would have a 3, first of all, if it was a 9. And then it would decrease to a 2. So that means we would change from dividing by 3 to dividing by 2. So if you think about it, that means that we are increasing our overall size of the result of this fraction, because we're going from dividing by 3 to dividing by 2, which means a bigger number. So the overall effect of the sample size decreasing is that there's an increase in the standard error of the mean. So if we look back at this question, what happens to the mean and standard deviation of the distribution of sample means as the size of the sample decreases? The answer is A. The mean of the sample mean stays constant. That's because it doesn't affect that formula. And the standard error increases. That was our answer. Okay, so A was the answer to that one. Now let's look at 13. 13 is another one where we can use the normal CDF formula. It says use a standard normal distribution to find the probability of Z being between negative 2.25 and 0. So this is one where you're going to do a between, and because it said standard normal distribution for this case, because it did not give us a mean and a standard deviation like this one did, we are going to use 0 and 1. So we use the lower bound, like it has here, it has z being between these two numbers. So the lower bound is the negative 2.25, and the upper bound is 0. And then we use 0 and 1 for our mean and standard deviation. And then the answer that we get is B, 0.4878. All right, let's look at 14. 14 says, find the area under the standard normal curve to the right of z equals negative 1.25. Okay, this is to the right. Excuse me, I have to cough. So this is one where we have to pay attention to the fact that it's to the right. If you're using your calculator, it doesn't mess with you that much because you just have to make sure you put it in the right position. If you're looking at the graph, you need to make sure that you find your answer and then subtract it from 1. If you're using your calculator, you can use normal CDF, and it did not give you a mean and standard deviation, so you can use 0 and 1 as those values. On where you put those values, the negative 1.25, because it's to the right, it wants the value to the right, you put that as your lower limit, your negative 1.25 as your lower limit, and then however you like to put your upper limit. I do the 1E99. You can put 10,000 or whatever you want to put there, but it needs to be a big positive number, and then put 0 and 1 and press enter. You should get A, 0.8944, for that answer. All right, number 15, provide an appropriate response, use a standard normal table to find the probability. IQ test scores are normally distributed with a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 15. Find the IQ scores that correspond to a z-score of 1.96. Okay, so this is finding the x. This is the opposite of finding a z-score. They gave you the z-score, so you have to find the x value. So we already have the z-score. So what I have done here is just done it algebraically. There is a formula that we have worked with before that has x equals and has this already worked out. I prefer to do it this way just because I know I have the values and I like to fill them in where they are and then work backwards so that I have x equals. If you do it this way, you put in your z-score and you put in your mu or your mean and your standard deviation that they gave you. You're using your z-score formula. When I did that, I multiplied through by 15. That gave me 29.4 equals x minus 100. And then I just added 100 to both sides to get my x equals 129.4, which is my answer, D, 129.4. I hope that helped you. Please let me know if you have any further questions. I apologize for my funny voice and coughing. And I will see you on Monday. I'm probably going to be wearing a mask. I apologize about that. I hope you're all doing well and that you understood what you were doing on 6-2. We'll see you in class. Thanks.